Technically, everything can kill you. It just depends on the dose. For example, it would take about 4 liters of water, about 3.5 pounds of sugar, but only a tiny, tiny amount of a toxin from the bacterium Clostridium tetani to kill me. Why is it that some compounds are so much more deadly? Today I want to go through 4 fatal toxins and the cellular mechanisms of how they kill you. If you're interested in hearing about how toxins have been historically used as medicine, check out Patrick Kelly's channel. The link is in the description. Okay, let's begin with colchicine, a poisonous alkaloid that can be found in 2 lily species. If you consume this compound at a dose higher than about 0.8 milligrams per kilogram, you will have symptoms similar to severe food poisoning. It starts with vomiting and diarrhea that will eventually lead to respiratory and cardiac failure and death. This sounds scary, however, if you lower the dose a few notches, this compound can be used as an anti-inflammatory medicine for gout. And its anti-inflammatory properties and its reputation as a swollen joint remedy have been known for a long time, noted in this 1890s medical book and referenced as early as 1550 BC in Egypt. So how does colchicine do its deadly deeds? It's a cytoskeleton disruptor. And the cytoskeleton is a network of fibers that gives the cell its shape, essentially the cell skeleton. However, unlike our skeleton, the cell skeleton is flexible and dynamic, constantly being broken and reformed. Colchicine binds to one of these skeletal fibers called microtubules and locks it into place, preventing it from polymerizing into the chain that supports the cell structure. This has consequences for both cell mobility and cell division. This compound can be used in molecular biology labs to stop cell division or to induce polyploidy. This compound is a deadly destroyer of cells, that is, to most animals. African porcupines are immune and can consume the lily with no side effects. Next, we have strychnine, which is a toxic alkaloid found in the seeds of a few plants native to Southeast Asia. Despite being pretty toxic, this compound has historically been used to treat all sorts of ailments, including constipation, emphysema, headache, irritability, nausea. This compound is now only legally allowed as a pesticide, but it has a legacy use as a performance-enhancing drug, most recently reported at the 2016 Olympics. But what if someone goes beyond doping with strychnine? Symptoms of its poisoning include severe muscle contractions that resemble a seizure and begin shortly after ingestion. This toxin can lead to respiratory failure within a few hours. Strychnine's path to causing involuntary muscle contractions starts at the spinal cord. This compound acts as a competitive inhibitor of glycine receptors on motor neurons in the spinal cord. Motor neurons are responsible for activating muscle contractions when they're firing. But these neurons need something to turn them off so that the muscles can relax again. And this is where the inhibitory inner neurons come in. They release inhibitory neurotransmitters like glycine, which bind to receptors on the motor neurons and turn them off. When strychnine is present, it blocks glycine from binding, forcing the motor neurons into a constant firing state and keeping muscles contracted. Strychnine is deadly to humans as well as rodents and many other animals. But there are some species, such as the fruit bat, that can tolerate this compound just fine. Next up is alpha-amanitin, a cyclic peptide produced by various mushroom species, including one aptly named death cap. This species is native to Europe, but has spread all over the world. It is especially dangerous because it looks like other non-toxic edible mushrooms and can be mistakenly eaten by novice foragers. Its appearance is inconspicuous and so is its mild, pleasant taste, but the consequences of consuming this mushroom are far from mild or pleasant. Consumption of this mushroom causes symptoms similar to severe food poisoning within a day, and these symptoms usually resolve within about 36 hours, making you think that you are better, but you're not. Ultimately, this toxin leads to liver failure in less than a week. Depending on the dosage of alpha-amanitin that was consumed, you could need a liver transplant for a chance of survival. Alpha-amanitin is a transcription inhibitor. This means it inhibits the cellular machinery needed to make messenger RNA, RNA polymerase II. Under normal conditions, your DNA provides instructions to make proteins, and RNA polymerase converts these instructions into RNA, which can be read by the ribosomes, which are the cell's protein factories. Without conversion into RNA, there is no way for the cell to make all the proteins necessary for survival, making cell death inevitable. Alpha-amanitin targets the liver, where it goes immediately after absorption by the small intestine. From there, it begins shutting down protein synthesis, preventing liver cells from metabolizing and detoxifying your body. So it's wise to avoid death caps, unless you're a squirrel or a rabbit. They are immune to this poison and can get away with eating death caps without dying. So if you're not a squirrel looking for a snack, alpha-amanitin also has uses in molecular biology. Because this compound preferentially inhibits RNA polymerase II, it can be used to investigate which genes are transcribed by the other polymerases, and to look at the effects of inhibiting transcription on a cellular scale. Moving on to the last one, which is one of the most toxic compounds known to humans, tetanospasmin. It's a protein toxin generated by a bacterium, Clostridium tetani, which lives in the soil and intestines of animals. This is the compound that causes tetanus, an illness leading to face spasms and increased muscle contraction, causing stiffness and immobility. Tetanus can cause respiratory failure within a few days after exposure. Tetanospasmin works by preventing the release of neurotransmitters, typically from inhibitory inner neurons in the spinal cord. This is similar to how strychnine works, except tetanospasmin prevents the release of inhibitory neurotransmitters, while strychnine prevents them from binding to their target. The estimated minimum lethal dose in humans is less than 2.5 nanograms per kilogram of body weight. Despite tetanospasmin being found in soils all over the world, you don't have to worry about dying from its muscle spasms because you probably have the tetanus vaccine. And if you don't remember the last time you got it, you should probably check. This toxin is not playing around. So what makes some of these compounds so lethal? Primarily physiology and dosage. At the right concentrations, even the most lethal of compounds can be useful as medicines and tools for scientists to understand cellular mechanisms. Organisms from all branches of life, fungi, bacteria, plants, and animals, generate compounds as defenses and weapons. But these molecules aren't necessarily just poisons. Poison is a relative term. While some of these compounds are used to ward off or kill predators, others have far less sinister purposes like signaling or communication. But in the wrong place and at the wrong amount, even something as innocuous as a porcupine's favorite snack can be deadly.